So now I'm just going to pass it on to Mackenzie.
Awesome. So hello, everyone. I'm Mackenzie Nicho, part of the events committee here at AMA-UCF. Today, as our guest speaker, we have Professor Raish. He's currently a professor here at the College of Business for International Business, and he will be talking about an international perspective on business with an emphasis on professional development and personal growth. Please hold off on all questions until the end, and Professor Raish, the floor is yours.
Okay, great. Mackenzie, let me share my screen with you guys. Well, first of all, thanks for the invitation. It's great that you have, like, you know, people who take the initiative, you know, which is extremely important. And, you know, when we talk, like, about personal and professional development, membership in an organization like AMA is really, really important. So if anybody is out there who's not a member, I can tell you, like, from a professional perspective, that is a really valuable aspect of going to college, to get involved, like, in a professional organization like that. Okay, anyway, without further ado, let me share my screen. Here we go. Okay, so you guys see my screen. Okay, anyway, so Mackenzie asked me to do this talk. I came up very quickly with this title, and then I started to think afterwards, oh, what am I going to talk about? So that's the official title. I give you the alternative title. You know, so I'm just going to tell you some of the things I've done, you know, what I learned and what I think is important for personal and professional development. So, you know, hopefully it will be useful for you. I know that some of you have taken my class, so you know a little bit about me. Well, anyway, so as you can hear from my accent, so I was born and raised and grew up in Germany in a place called Karlsruhe, you know, which is the town with a green circle around it. So it's like a 15-minute drive to France, southwestern part of Germany. You know, I grew up like in the countryside, small place, mountains, you know, very different from Orlando. Not sure how good your geography is. You know, Germany is basically smack in the middle of Europe. And of course, if you grow up in Europe, you know, your life is very different, or the way you grow up is very different in the sense is that by the time you're 18, you know, you've seen or you've been to many, many countries. So if you grow up in Europe, you know, when we do like high school excursions, you know, we go like to France or to Italy and things like that. You know, when we go to summer vacation, we go to Spain, or we go to France, or we go to Italy, or we go like to Greece, you know, to the one of the islands, or we go to the UK. And things like that. So growing up in Europe is, you know, very different than growing up from the States. But of course, the size of European countries is very small compared to the United States. So you just have, it's just easier to see a lot of different countries. Okay, anyway, so I grew up there, went to school, graduated from high school, and then I took a strange decision because I decided to go to college in the United States. Now, anybody can tell me why this is a strange decision for somebody who grew up in Germany? Why is it strange? No one?
Because it's a lot different than Germany. You're moving
Okay, a lot different, but there's an important factor. How much do you pay for university in Germany? Nothing, free. Education is free. Basically, education is free in all European countries, basically. Of course, it's not free because somebody has to pay for it. You know, the system is just different. In Europe, you can study whatever you want. You want to become a medical doctor, lawyer, whatever. You can go to university, you don't pay. But of course, the government or the state has to recuperate like the investment in you, and they recuperate the investment by charging higher, by collecting higher taxes once you start working. But anyway, so I figured for me, it would be more interesting to go to New York. My parents said, okay, that's a crazy idea, but if that's what you want to do, of course you have to pay for yourself. So I flew like with $1,500 in my pocket and an address of a friend of my sister. That's not a joke. I flew to New York in order to enroll myself in Baruch College, which is like the business school of the City University of New York system. Biggest business school in the United States. And of course, being in New York, extremely multicultural, right? What does it say? So just the business school has over 19,000 students. who speak more than 110 languages and trace their heritage to more than 168 countries. So for me, that was like the first time to be like in a place that was super multicultural. And of course, New York is New York. So anyway, but as I said, so I managed to enroll myself into college. And of course, I had to pay for college. And so I worked while I was in college, I worked like as a tour guide for international tourist groups, so German-speaking tourist groups in New York. And in the summer, I did the tours like to Canada and stuff like that. It served like a lot of purposes, so it paid for college, you know, but two of the most important things I learned from working as a tour guide, one, extremely important, has come in very handy, how to deal with people. That's where I learned how to deal with people. And I'm not sure if you guys learned that, but the ability to deal with people is the most important ability in professional success. We always forget that, but that's how it is. And that's where I learned and how to deal like with conflict and things like that. Second major takeaway, I learned really how to manage my time because I attended college full time and I worked quite a bit. Okay, so two important takeaways from my time as a tour guide. But I also did a year-long internship in the Business Council for International Understanding, also in New York, abbreviated BCIU. And what does BCIU do? They basically help companies that are interested in specific countries or companies that do business internationally to get the right contacts, to form like relationships. And so we organized, well, I can show you like that's from their webpage, like from what's going on like this month. So they invite like senior American diplomats, ambassadors and things like that. They organize like roundtables with business leaders on specific country issues, on general issues like intellectual property, or here, this one here, the second one in Latin America and things like that. So it's like an organization. It's really interesting. And I really hadn't any idea about all, you know, the other aspect of business of, like the really big picture of business. And so, you know, companies, they do whatever they're doing, but at the same time, they have to know what's going on in the world and they have to understand like what the pressing issues is. And they want to get an idea what like the US policy is, and they need contacts, relationships, right? And so very interesting experience from that. I mean, okay, well, it's bciu.org. So we organized roundtables and discussions between like US diplomats, senior diplomats. We had like the Secretary of State and all of these guys, we brought them together with business leaders. And from that internships to the two most important takeaways from this one was just to get an insight, as I said, like to get, you know, an insight into behind the scenes aspect of business, and particularly big businesses. Because big businesses, they do a lot of things behind the scene that you're never aware of. And one big issue is relationship buildings, like with people of influence and things like that, and building relationships to get information that is extremely important for them. And the second takeaway is just like the realization of the importance of high-level relationships and networking that firms have to do. I mean, you guys are networking, right? And you learn how to network, but companies have to do the same thing. So anyway, that was an interesting experience too. My major was international marketing. Just what I got out of 4 years of college in New York, of course, a fantastic experience. New York is a very wild place, but I also got a profound sense of achievement because I did this everything on my own. And of course, I increased my versatility in terms of roles that I was able to take and environments in which I was able to work, right? Because, and that's all like this being versatile, like in the job market or for firms or just in general is a really important one. And like I did a few other internships as well, but that was a major benefit. And of course the realization, you know, that everything is possible. And a lot of people have like a lot of like inhibitions or things, I cannot do that, I cannot do that. The fact is that you can really do everything. If you want to do something, you can do it. You know, I flew to New York with $1,500 in my pocket and I managed to get like through college as well. So that's like the, a big takeaway from that one too. And after the 4 years in college in New York, I just lost like complete fear of like everything, you know, just nothing seemed to be like too daunting. Okay, but anyway, and so I got out. First job out of college, I worked for a global communication agency. A global communication agency that is part of the Omnicom group. I'm not sure if you guys, is anyone familiar with Omnicom? So Omnicom is like this extremely large company that owns a lot of different agencies specialized in every aspect of communication, right? So they have PR agencies, advertising agencies, digital agencies, and things like that. So Omnicom is like the shell, so to speak. Well, what does it say here? So these are like some of their creative networks, you know, that they own. I'm sure that you guys are familiar with some of them, right? DDB, BBDO, TBWA. So like the big advertising companies are all part of the Omnicom groups, right? And so they basically have over 1,500 agencies around the world. Okay, but anyway, so that was the parent company, and I worked specifically for one agency called Ketchum. Ketchum is primarily public relations, media relations, corporate events and things like that. And, you know, just like a reality of companies today is that they're all over the place, right? So this Ketchum agency, they have agencies around the world. Wherever you have big business or wherever you have business, you have agencies, right? Communications agencies of every type. They sent me to work out in the München, that's Munich in English. And so they have the headquarters on Madison Avenue in New York, and they sent me to work in the Munich office, because in the Munich office, they needed a native German speaker, but look all over the world. So if you work for an agency like that, basically your possibilities are endless, right? Asia Pacific, that's just like a few. And of course they have a presence in many US countries. Okay, and so some of the things that I did there, my biggest project was work on a corporate identity campaign for a new spin-off. I'm not sure if you guys are familiar with what corporate identity campaigns are. No? Okay, well, anyway, so the situation was, it was a big company in Switzerland, and they spun off a part of their business, right? It's sometimes you read about it with big companies and they spin off certain parts of their business for a variety of reasons. Okay, but anyway, so you have like a new entity, a new like corporation that doesn't have any identity, you know, an identity in terms of like, what is the company about? What is like the company's like vision and mission and things like, what's the company's logo and how does like the company communicate and things like that? It's an extremely complex issue, but anyway, and so we worked like with an advertising agency in London at the time, which was Saatchi & Saatchi. And so we developed like, you know, the logo, the slogan, and everything that relates to the appearance of the company to the outside world, towards investors, towards their own employees and things like that. It was very interesting. I did quite a bit of media relations for the trade press. So one of the biggest customer or client of this agency in the Munich office was the European subsidiary of an American company located in Switzerland. And so a company, they have to communicate a lot. And it's the biggest plastic producer in the world. And so they communicate a lot, you know, through like the trade press and things like that. And so I spend a lot of time like in Switzerland to work out things with them, also events, you know, like a company, they want to form relations with their best customers. They said, okay, we want to make like a big event for our top 50 global customers in the world, come up like with like a really cool idea. And so we decided to rent like the entire Titanic exhibition, which was at that time in Hamburg. And we rented like the entire exhibition and then put on like a very fancy event for like the top customers of this American multinational. We did a lot of like corporate events. And also something interesting that we did, that we did media training for executives, right? Because how does an executive give an interview on television, on radio? What can executives say? What can't they say? How do they have to appear and things like that? So interesting thing too. So, you know, very varied type of activities, but it's an agency. It's like an, you know, like an advertising agency. And an agency is a place where you have like a lot of like young people working. It's a very informal environment. In the Munich office, we had like, you know, starting at 6 o'clock, we had an open bar. We had a bar in the agency. You know, the meeting containers were like, you know, shipping containers. So very on the creative side. Okay, but anyway, at 6 o'clock, open bar, we could like drink beer while we were working and things like that. So it's like this agency environment, which is, you know, attractive, at least for a certain period of time. Two important things that I learned is like, among many other things. First time that I had to work like in an international team. You know, to work like with people from the same agency, which work in different locations. So I worked a lot with people from an agency like in Italy and things like that. That was my first experience to that. And but at the same time, I also learned, and that's very important for everybody and for you guys too. You have to realize when it's time to move on. Very, very important. It sounds very, you know, very easy, but that's something that you need to develop like for everything. And if you're like in a job and it's like fulfilling, but you will get to the point where you just, you know, you don't get more out of it, or you just feel, okay, now it's ready for the next step. And that's, I developed it after like, you know, whatever, 2.5 years or 3 years, like with the agencies, I felt, okay, now I have to move on, right? Because I'm not going to get, you know, ahead further. So anyway, what do you do? I decided to do an MBA, and I decided to do an MBA in at a school called Sade. It's in Barcelona, Spain. And I participated, I did the last semester was a 2-year full-time program, and I participated in an exchange program with the Monterrey Institute of Technology in Mexico. Sade, extremely very good school in Europe. It's like one of like the top 5 schools in Europe. An extremely good school located in Barcelona, Spain. I'm not sure if anyone has been there. A fantastic place. My classes were in English, but my classmates were from all over the world, right? So it's also a very international university. It's a private university. It's not cheap, but I paid for that myself too. So very diverse student body, and a very good school. And of course, the reality of businesses, of schools, is they're connected. And in terms of like schools, they are connected to a lot of other universities through agreements, like, you know, exchange agreements and things like that. So we had the possibility to study basically to do one semester anywhere in the world, right? And well, anyway, and so I picked a university in Monterrey, Mexico, the Monterrey Institute of Technology. That's Monterrey, Mexico. My best classes I ever took in the MBA were, by the way, in Mexico. It was fantastic. And well, anyway, so it was the 2-year program. What I got out of the MBA experience, living in one of the most happening cities in Europe, I mean, which is Barcelona. I mean, there are few cities like Barcelona, so great experience. But it also gave me the chance to go to Latin America, you know, which turned out to be a pretty important aspect of like this MBA experience. I made friends from around the world, and I became even more versatile, right? Because I lived in a completely different environment what I was used to. I had to deal with people from very, very different countries, heavy Latin influence and things like that. And of course, the things that we did and that we learned in school just made me like more versatile. Okay, anyway, and then I graduated and my first job after the MBA, I worked in management consulting. Does anybody know what management consulting firms do? Like in a nutshell, there are many types of consulting, but specifically management consulting. Anyone? Come on, folks. No one? Okay, doesn't matter. So a management consulting firm helps companies to solve many different types of problems, right? And so what are the problems that many companies face? Okay, companies have to find ways to become more efficient, to lower their cost base, to increase sales. They want to expand. They want to expand nationally or internationally, but don't know how best to do it and things like that. So management consulting is about solving or providing problems to challenges that firms face. And of course, it's a project. It's a project business, right? So consulting projects, they last between like 3 and 6 months. They work like in many different fields. And for that, that company is primarily active in Central and South America. Now also in a little bit in the United States and in Europe. But I worked exclusively in Central and South America. So my projects that I did were basically all around here, right? So my first project was in Venezuela, but it was at the time when Venezuela was a lot better than it's now. And then Puerto Rico, Guatemala, basically most of like the countries, Ecuador. And it's like this non-stop business. It's like a job where you work like 16 hours a day, 6 days a week. So you don't really get to see like too much of the countries you're in. So it's an extremely intense experience. And so some of the things, I mean, I did just like various types of consulting projects, right? So I had to find ways to increase sales. So if your direct partner in this project can be like the director of marketing or sales. And then you have to think, okay, what can you guys do? You do like a lot of like analysis, like, you know, product or product analysis, customer analysis. It's not necessarily good for a company to try to serve all customers, particularly if it's business to business. Find ways to cut costs, process re-engineering, and things like that. So I'm not sure if you guys have like, if I give you like a very vague idea what management consulting is about, but that's basically that, where you have to find ways for companies to achieve a certain objectives. And the industries I worked in, very, very different, they're very diverse, financial, bank, consumer products. We had a big project with Kimberly-Clark, big consumer products company. And there, the situation was there, that was in Puerto Rico. You have one company, Kimberly-Clark, bought a competitor. And if one company buys another company, you have like the problem of how do you integrate like this new company into like, the big company or like the acquiring company. And so it's all about like, you know, processes. It's about like training and things like that. Very interesting. And retail and a lot of other things. So many, many different industries. And of course, I had no idea about most of these industries. But the thing is, if you do like an MBA, you're expected to learn like extremely fast, right? You can't take like a year to figure out like how a bank works. You have like exactly 2 days to do so. So a lot of like stress. So what I got out of the exciting experience, how to perform in a high pressure professional environment, but extremely high pressure professional environment, really trained my analytical thinking, right? Coming up with solutions for problems, because that's what consulting is about. It's about like analytical thinking. Of course, it also gave me a great exposure to a wide range of industries, companies, and executives. And of course, for me, it was a complete immersion into a different culture, because for almost 4 years, I didn't even go back to Europe. I was nonstop in Central and South America, and that was a really interesting experience as well. Okay, but then at some point, and I did a couple of other things, but then at some point I took a 6 months break and I went backpacking in South America. And I started like in the northeast of Brazil and then did like Carnival in Brazil. And then went all the way back to the southern tip of Chile and Argentina and then back up on the coast. Sometimes you have to take a break. That's very important too. And what I got out of this backpacking trip, well, a life was of unforgettable memories and a lot of adventures too. So, you know, if you think back, the things that you remember, you know, like of the last 5 years, 10 years, you remember things like that, right? You don't really remember like what you did like in the office every day, but these are like types of experiences that like stay with you for, you know, for life. Okay, but anyway, so what was the impact of spending 4 years in Latin America for me in general? Basically a new perspective on just about everything. And I learned a little bit, I mean, I learned Spanish too. And what do I mean by a new perspective on just about everything? Well, it just completely changed like my entire outlook. Well, on everything really, on things like security, stuff that you never think about, you know, just like the outlook on life, right? Because in Germany, like everything, everybody's like very stressed. In Central America, the culture is very like different, a lot more relaxed. I used to be like extremely impatient, right? In Germany, everything has to be right on time. Latin America, okay, if it doesn't happen now, it's going to happen at some other point. And so it made me like a lot more relaxed, right? It changed like my perspective on, you know, how you value certain things, you know, what does it, you start to appreciate things that you'd never appreciated before. And that's simply to have opportunities, because if you live for a while in the poorer countries, you see that the vast majority of people, they don't have the opportunities that you have and that, you know, that I have and things like that. You know, it changed my perspective on family, right? In Germany, like, you know, family is not very important. Latin American, you know, cultures are extremely like family focused. And that changed like the relation to my mom changed, like, you know, significantly and things like that. So it's a little bit difficult to, you know, to put into words, but that has had like a profound impact on me and a very valuable too. So just made me like a lot more relaxed and develop the ability to just see things like from, you know, from a completely different perspective, so to speak, and so on. So just a few things. So on personal and professional growth and development, and I really believe this. So interesting jobs require interesting people, folks. That's the truth, right? That's how it is. And interesting people are those who find ways to grow, to grow personally. Okay, and what is personal growth and development, you know, about? So, you know, it's about like activities, things that you do, you know, that develop what it says here, your capabilities and potential, build human capital, facilitate employability and enhance quality of life and the realization of aspirations and so on. So, you know, I've met like a lot of really interesting people and really doing extremely interesting things, but you find out that the people doing extremely interesting things are also extremely interesting like people, right? And, you know, the question that you have to answer, you guys need to answer, how do I want to grow? And many of you have already taken like the first right step because you're organized and you're active, like in AMA, for example. That's like one thing, you know, that helps you to grow, that helps you to grow like personally. And as we will see, of course, personal growth is directly correlates like with professional growth as well. And so everybody has to answer this question for themselves. And what I did, you know, I don't say everybody has to do it, you know, it just worked for me. So I don't say, okay, if you want to, you know, grow, you have to live abroad and stuff like that. That's not what I mean. But I think this is really important that you think, you know, how do you want to grow? But, you know, growth comes, well, you know, what helps us grow are experiences and not the things we buy or own, for example. So like this personal growth, you know, which leads to professional growth are experiences, right? So because if you think, you know, if that's like us, like we said here, you know, we consist out of many different, you know, we have like things that we know like the experiences that we have, you know, the things that we want to do, like our values and things like that. But who we are, you know, as people and as professionals changes, and it has to change, right? We cannot stay, just get stuck in one place. And so an interesting question is like, how, you know, think about it. How do you want to grow? I told you, like, you know, the things that helped me grow, like, you know, personally and professionally, but, you know, things. So, you know, experiences, try to do interesting things. And as I showed you, like with the backpacking trips, a lot of the things that help you to grow are not necessarily related to like to your job or to your profession or to your field, right? And so anyway, and the relationship of personal and professional growth and development is of course that one drives the other, right? You cannot have professional growth without personal growth and vice versa. So they both reinforce you, and the more you grow professionally, the more you grow personally as well too, right? But don't underestimate like the value of like this personal growth, because of course in college it's all about like learning a lot of things, of course, which is like the basis for everything, you know, but still there is like another dimension which will become extremely important. And if it's simply, you know, if you develop an ability to deal with all sorts of people, which has been extremely useful, you know, for me. But you have to find a way, how do I develop that, right? And of course, you know, to find ways or these activities that help you grow are fun. You know, it's not like something that I drag, oh, I have to do that to grow. No, it's something fun. It's like, you know, adventures and things like that. So professional growth requires personal growth, and one reinforces the other, right? And personal and professional growth implies developing a broader perspective of things, right? And what is a perspective? The capacity to view things in their true relations or relative importance. Now, and the thing is, if you speak like with people who have been, for example, all over the place, or have done like a lot of different things, you see that they're able to see things from different perspectives, but also are able to see which things are really like important. And that's something that you develop over time too, right? So that is like, and well, anyway, and that is to have like, you know, a good perspective on things, or like a wide perspective is useful for everything, like for personal, you know, issues, professional issues and things like that. But anyway, so this, you know, this personal growth and then the professional growth, you know, leads you to have different, you know, like a broader perspective, or just, and that is important to see really things how they are, or like what is more important than something else. And it's good, like for, you know, selecting like a job, you know, doing stuff, not doing stuff, and so on, right? And so having a broad perspective helps you to identify the right problems, which is extremely important. Find better solutions if like your perspective is like very narrow. I mean, if your perspective is very narrow, you don't see like 95% of all the problems. And of course, if you don't see 95% of all the problems, you will never able to come up like with like solutions, right? So, and it works in that way, right? It helps you to make right decisions, which is based on perspective, you know, and appreciate what you have, right? And so again, my time spending in Latin America really made me appreciate a lot of the things that I simply took for granted. And if it's to have like clean drinking water, security, that you don't have to be afraid to go out at night and stuff like that. So very, very useful. And of course, like to see new opportunities, right? And so, you know, one thing that like what my experience has helped me to do is that you see when it's simply that I see like opportunities in a very broad way, like geographically. So if I think, okay, I want to get like, you know, change my job. Okay, well, you know, what I take into consideration is extremely broad. And so maybe I go like next to Asia or something like this, or I can do something better, but you need to have like the right perspective, right? The perspective of you, who you are, and you have to see like the opportunities. And most people they don't see like all the opportunities they have. And perspective also helps you to be more creative. Okay, I'm going to hurry up. Okay, example, just as you guys are marketing people, just want to finish with that one. Example of different perspective. And from an ad campaign by HSBC, they make fantastic advertisement. I'm not sure if you're familiar with them. It's a bank and they had like this campaign point of values advertising campaign. So what is that? What do you see?
A cow.
Okay, very good. Okay, but if you have like a broader perspective, you see that you can see that in a completely different way. Come on, folks, you are marketing people. Creativity, okay, what is it? So it's a cow?
Any ideas for anybody else?
Come on, folks.
I'm not seeing
at it.
Like, or do you mean like actually seeing it or like a metaphor?
Well, I mean, just like what you can associate this with. I mean, you can say that's a cow and that's it, right? But of course, you can also see that.
Someone says milk.
No?
Milk.
Okay. Milk? Ah, okay. Well, maybe. Yeah, sure. Yeah, okay. There's milk. What else?
Someone says beef.
Ah, very good. Okay, now you guys are getting the hang of it. Look. That's the advertising campaign, right? It'd be dinner. I mean, beef. If you go to India, a cow is holy, right? Very important. You cannot kill a cow. You cannot eat a cow. So depending where you are. But of course, you can see it like as a, you know, as leather. That's where the leather comes from, right? Cow hides. And it's just a very clever idea where you just play on the idea of different perspective. I'll give you like another one. How can you see that? Of course, that's a dog, right? But what is a dog?
A best friend.
Yeah, okay. Something like a best friend. No, it's true. Best friend.
So what else? Says family.
Okay. Best friend, family. Of course, I don't give you like a lot of time to think, but you kind of get the idea, you know, is to have like, you know, you see something, but you know, it's the reality is that you can, that people can see the same thing, but they see something different, or they, for them, this thing, you know, represents like something completely different. Okay, well, I give you, can be like a companion. I mean, that's from their campaign, right? Companion accessory, or see like a dog is like an alarm clock, which is true, right? They wake you up like in the morning. Clever idea. What about this one? What do you think about if you see this? Say it.
Bald head.
Okay.
The person might be sick and going.
Ah, okay. Yeah. Very good. One more. And there is a, huh?
They could also be a monk.
Ah, okay. Very good. Yeah. Could be. Yeah. True. So it's not sickness, but maybe it's religious or like a monk. Yeah. Okay. You kind of get the idea. Look. Can see that is like in terms of like style, soldier, survivor, right? If you had like cancer or something like that. You see that? Fantastic, very clever idea. Accomplishment. You know, what is an accomplishment? And of course, an accomplishment can be like many, many different things to different people, right? It can be winning like a contest, going to the moon, or just being able to tie your shoes for the first time. That's a big accomplishment too. So, yeah, mother and the children. What is it? Is it a privilege, sacrifice, role model? Subway, you know, print ad, organic, imported, engineered, like an apple. What is security? Kind of an interesting question too. You know, you ask people, what is security? Well, different things mean security for different people, so to speak, right? Can be like your island protected, can be like your teddy bear, can be like your password. Perfect, imperfect, imperfect, perfect. Yeah, an open mind is the best way to look at the world. Work, play, play, work. Kind of interesting too. And I really like this one. Holiday, hell, hell, holiday. Right? Think about it. It's really clever, but it makes like a really important point that, you know, you have to be able to see like different viewpoints and to have like, you know, or be able to have like a different perspective on things, right? Or on the same thing, that you can simply see something from different sides. Okay, but anyway, that was like the ad campaign to finish off here. One good motto to have, like a last word of wisdom. If you have one motto in life, that's my favorite one. And I'm not sure if you're familiar with that, but in my opinion, that's exactly what it's about. That's exactly that. Have you heard this one before? No? Okay, think about it. Extremely good, but for me, that really hits it. And for you guys, you know, young professionals or aspiring professionals, that's it. You know, how do you stick out of the crowd? How can you be like different? Like what makes you, well, anyway, what helps you grow? And it's like that type of stuff. So anyway, that's my favorite motto. And no, I'm not sure if anybody has like any questions. I can probably like stop. Can I stop share?
Yeah, okay. You can stop it. Yeah.
Okay. Well, anyway, so that was like my little thing.
Thank you so much, Professor.
No, my pleasure. But you kind of get the idea of what I'm telling you. I think that's really important. You know, and one thing, as I said, you know, you have, most people don't see the opportunities they have. You can do like anything that you want. And very important is like not to be afraid to do things. You know, that I've never had this inhibition. And that really allowed me to do many things, you know, that most of my friends never did, right? They never saw all of the stuff because they were like afraid or it's money. Well, do anything. Money is, you always find a way to make things happen, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, anyway, what else? Yeah. Anybody question?
I think Christian has a question.
Okay. Just speak out.
Hello, Professor.
Hey.
So I find your experience, like your global experience, very fascinating. And I just kind of am curious about it. So one of the things that you mentioned was how your perspective on certain aspects have changed, specifically around time, family, and everything.
Mm-hmm.
Just curious, and maybe if you can speak a little bit about this, but what was the moment that you realized like, okay, maybe I should take a step back, or maybe instead of setting expectations for other people that I'm used to, maybe I should adapt to the way that their customs, their flow of things. And just to give you like an example, I'm a very time-oriented person. I go on a thing like, if you're not 15 minutes early, you're late. So I keep a calendar, and it's how I do everything. And one of the things that frustrates me the most, not in general culturally, just in general, is like when you and I set out time to do a specific thing, and it almost feels kind of like, I don't want to use the word disrespectful, but like, I set out my time to do this. Like we, you know, I had deadlines, I had this, and it's now like a snowball. So how did you adapt working different cultures, customs, and expectations? I was wondering if you could speak a little bit more towards
that. I mean, you know, the thing is, if you don't adapt, you get into a lot of trouble. And when I started my job in the consulting firm, I got into a lot of trouble initially, because there are like a few things. I'm not, if you're like, you know, power distance, right? In Latin America, people are extremely hierarchical. And so they expect, you know, they respect power a lot. So like the subordinates, they don't speak up to their superiors, right? So that's like this hierarchical society, it's power distance. Okay, like, you know, you are like United States, Europe is low power distance. I feel free to speak my mind, right? But you know, if you feel free to speak your mind, for example, if you contradict what your boss said, or your boss says something in front of a group of people and you say, you know, I disagree, I have a better idea. You know, it's like an insult on their you know, or like on their person. And they got, I got into a lot of trouble because at first I always spoke out. And then you kind of realize, okay, well, you know, of course you think, okay, these people are strange, but you kind of get the way, okay, if I want to make a suggestion, you know, I have to do it like in another way. You know, you have to respect like, you know, the, like, you know, the pyramid, and you have to respect that when you say something that they take it as an assault on their authority, you know, but you just find other ways, right? You know, first talk like to your colleagues or something like that. And then find like the right moment, right? And in what environment? Never in the office, always afterwards when you're standing at the bar and having a drink and something, you know, you kind of learn how to work like your way around it. And of course, you know, there's something called ethnocentrism, and ethnocentrism refers like to the fact that we think that the way that we do things, that this is the correct way, like you, right? You're punctual, you have like a calendar and things like that. And then you meet like somebody who has just a different time organization, and that's somewhat inferior. You agree? Because like you are doing the right thing. You are like very efficient, effective, and things like that. You know, the reality of the world is that everybody has a different take on a million different things. And I learned, you know, whatever, you know, people just do things differently, right? If they're like, you know, late, I know that they're going to be late, so I'm going to prepare. If some people do, you know, do that or this way or that way, you know, but you need to develop like this ability, you know, to adjust like, you know, to others and to overcome like this idea that the way that you do things is the best way, because the reality of work is that you work with people from all over the world, right? And unless you're like the CEO who can say, okay, folks in my company, that's how we're going to do things, you always have to find like a way to work, like to collaborate with other people. And it's, you know, making compromise, but you see, they also get their stuff done, but just in a different way, right? So I've become, as I became like very good in overcoming like my German, like, you know, whatever, structural, whatever. And that puts you like at ease, you know, and just enables you to work like with a lot more people.
Thank you very much, Professor. Sure.
Anybody else?
Yes.
All right.
So did you have any prior Spanish knowledge before going to Spain?
Zero.
How did you adjust? You're in a completely different...
You know, the thing was like the following. In Barcelona, I really didn't learn Spanish because my classes were in English. And a lot of my classmates were like from Colombia and Brazil, you know. But the thing is, if you have two foreigners meeting, you speak the default language is English anyway, right? So I only spoke English in Barcelona. I had every day, I had like 1 hour of Spanish class, but you know, I didn't learn that much. And then when I went to Mexico, then everything was 100% in Spanish. And so I got like a crash course in Spanish, and to do like an MBA class in a language of which you understand like 30%, that is difficult. But anyways, but it's possible. No, it's, even when I started to work in the consulting firm, my Spanish was like at 70%. But so, I mean, it's like a lot of, you know, a lot of sweat, but you learn it. I mean, you learn it like, you know, smoothly, or you learn it like, you know, in a crash course type of format.
I see.
Right. Mm-hmm. But Spanish is an extremely useful language. If you were thinking about picking up a second language, Spanish is it. A lot more useful than any other language. No point in learning Chinese. Spanish, because it's spoken in so many countries, right? Also in the United States, you guys do marketing, right? The Latino market, extremely important, you know, for marketing, advertising, and things like that. So if you ever think about picking up a second language, Spanish, that's the way to go.
Yeah, I do have some Spanish knowledge, but I definitely need to brush up since I haven't taken classes since high school.
Yeah, but you know, the thing with languages is if you don't use it, you lose it.
Yeah, did that happen to you with your German when you moved to Spain and Mexico?
No, as you can hear, my German is still very prevalent. Of course, I talk every day in German, right? Because I have German friends, I talk like to my family. You know, every day I talk, you know, 1 hour of the day I talk in German. So, but anyway, if I wouldn't speak a word in German for a couple of years, probably I would start to make a lot of mistakes and things like that too. Yeah, it happens very quickly. Yeah? But you just have to keep using it.
Mm-hmm. I see. Thank you.
Yeah.
I have a question, Professor.
Sure.
So I was wondering, what would you be see as more beneficial? Would it be like an internship abroad, or would you do the like kind of an exchange slash class abroad?
I mean, I think both, if you, I mean, either one, you know, either one is fine. Of course, you know, internships are always a little bit tricky because it really depends what they have you do in the internship. I mean, you guys probably have done like some internship where you were not really doing like a lot, you know, right? Where you don't really learn a lot. So I don't think it's possible to say this is better than that. I mean, either way is good. I mean, is fine. But of course, typically like internships have like a higher requirement in terms of foreign language, you know, than like if you take a semester abroad, because the classes you would take would probably be in English. But anyway, go if you have the chance for either one, definitely. You know, that's what they're looking for. They're looking for experiences in people, right? And that makes you stick out, right? And if you know, well, and if it's like an internship, like in this country, that makes you interesting. I tell you, interesting jobs need interesting people. So either one of them, you know, makes you more interesting.
Great. Thank you so much.
Sure.
Professor, I just wanted to ask, when you spoke about your like shift in values as a result of your travels and kind of that experience also affected you in the workplace. How has everything you've experienced up to now influenced you as a professor and kind of your attitudes towards teaching, kind of creating this next generation of people in your field?
Well, I mean, you know, one thing that I learned is that it's impossible to plan your career ahead, right? Because I sometimes just let like things happen, right? And not even remotely, I thought about, you know, teaching one day, not even remotely. But, you know, if you do like, you know, like things like that, you become like a lot more flexible and you're more willing to take like a risk. And so I took like the risk when I took like a break, I got an invitation to teach in this Monterey Institute of Technology. You know, I had never even thought about teaching a class. I said, okay, you know what? I'm going to give it a shot. You know, so it's like, it makes you like more relaxed, you know, you cannot plan like everything ahead. You know, sometimes you just let things go, you know, just flow to think what might be interesting and then see like what comes out of it. And that's exactly what happened with me, right? And that's how I came to teaching, completely unplanned. And then what happens is that, you know, you will discover a lot of things that you never thought you would even like before, you know, if you do different things. If you just do one thing, you don't see like, you know, maybe there are a lot of other things that you really would like to do too, you know? So, I mean, the entire reason why I'm teaching is, you know, it's because I just took a chance and just see like, okay, you know, whatever. It makes you like more relaxed, right? And you see, okay, well, if something doesn't work out, well, it's not the end of the world, right? You know, you have just try out something that looks interesting. Okay, try it out. Nobody's can tell you if it's going to work out or if it's going to get you ahead, you know. So it's to get away like from this like strict like, you know, career planning. You can't, because like, you know, you might come over like an idea or like an issue or like an opportunity that you've never thought about before, right? It's very possible. Like 99% of possibilities you don't even know exist. And then I think it's important just to say, okay, listen, I'm going to just jump into the cold water and see what happens, right? And you know, it turns out that I really like teaching. I never liked to go to university, never. You know, never. I thought about when I left the MBA, I'm never going to go back to school, never. Terrible classes, bad professors and things like that. But it turns out that I really like it. You know, I like to deal like with people, you know, and so a lot of, you know, things happen by kind of like a planned coincidence, right? Where you just try something out and then see where it leads to. So that's, you know, maybe a good one, right? So in terms for you guys, in terms of career planning, don't put like too much pressure on you, you know, what you want to do. In 5 years, you might be doing something very different and that's perfectly okay. So it's just to be like more relaxed about it. You know, always do like your best. Always, I mean, whenever you do something, put in like 100% effort. That's really important. Everything that you do, try to give, I mean, do like give 100%, you know, and then just see like, you know, where it's going to take you and keep like your eyes open. And, you know, like the more you've seen, like the more opportunities you see, right? And the more work experience you have, you know, the more, you know, the more opportunities will present themselves along the way, right?
Well, unfortunately, we kind of have to wrap up. But a couple people do have some questions for you still. So if you could drop your email information and your contact
information. Okay, I'm just going to write it in the chat, right?
Yeah, just so, because some I know some people are wanting to seek professional advice. So that would be awesome, yeah, if you don't mind.
Okay, let me see. So it's simply my first and last name at UCF, Peter Resch at UCF.edu. If anybody has a question, just email me, okay?
Okay, perfect. Thank you so much for coming.